Morning, everyone. I want to just begin this meeting by acknowledging that we're on Treaty 1 land, traditional homeland of the Métis. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to all those that have joined us in person. Thanks for visiting City Hall and for joining us this morning, as well as all those that are watching online. I will first begin just by asking for adoption of the minutes of the previous meeting. Thanks, Councillor. All in favour? Carried. Thanks very much. Before we welcome delegates, I do want to wish everybody a happy Winnipeg Day. 144 years ago today, Winnipeg was incorporated. Each and every day since that time, some more than others, we continue to improve as a city. And, you know, we certainly should all be very proud of the community that we and our predecessors have helped build. Winnipeg continues to be an inclusive place. Probably one of the best examples in the world where we celebrate and champion diversity, and it's something that I know many people in Winnipeg still to this day work very, very hard to build a community that we're all proud to call home. And so I want to wish everybody a very happy Winnipeg Day, and hopefully everybody can take a moment to truly appreciate the city that that we have the privilege of living in. I understand there's a few other opening remarks. Councillor Gillingham.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I just want to acknowledge, I think, the fact that everyone knows, or just want to acknowledge what everybody knows, and that's the fact that this coming weekend on Saturday is Remembrance Day, and as a Council Liaison for Veteran Military Affairs, and I thank you for the reappointment. It's an honour to work with the men and women of our armed services, both those that currently serve and those that are veterans of various both Army, Navy, and the Air Force. And so I would encourage everyone in Winnipeg, young and old, to take time this weekend to remember and acknowledge the great work of our current members and our past veterans as well. And there are a lot of Remembrance Day services throughout the city, and so I'd encourage everyone to make sure that they attend one of the Remembrance Day services and ensure that they're wearing a poppy as well. And I think if you're here today and you don't have one, I know they're available at our front desk as well. So thank you.
Thanks, Councillor. Councillor Mays?
Yeah, I just wanted to take the opportunity on a less somber note to wish well to the University of Manitoba Bisons. The women's soccer program is hosting the national championships this weekend. I'm going to be there for some of it. And so we wish well to the Bisons women's soccer team. I think it's the first time they've hosted the Nationals, and they're playing this actually indoors at the indoor facility, which I would note some of our predecessors and Councillor Pragtakan in 2007 voted for a $6 million city contribution to build the indoor soccer complex at U of M, and good to see that that's being taken advantage of, good partnership with U of M, and national championships are going to be played there. So we wish well to U of M sports program.
You're here. Thanks very much. Before we welcome delegations, I know we've got a number of delegates that want to speak today, and thanks to everybody for taking time out of your busy schedules to come down and provide your input on the matters that you'll be speaking to. I just will remind everybody that following the rules that we do have here at City Hall, I would just ask that the gallery refrain from applause, jeers, or other noise, so that we can focus on the conversation and the input that we're receiving from delegates. And so I'm going to try to ask that we all respect that for the benefit of the speakers as well as members of Executive Policy Committee and those that are watching online or via other means. We'll start with delegations.
First delegation registered, we have Councillor Reedy to be heard on a few subjects. We have religious for not-for-profit cemeteries, frontage levy exemption. That would be report one of an under EPC. Winnipeg Police Board proposed amendment to the Winnipeg Police Board bylaw number 148 of 2012, board compensation, composition, I apologize. That's report two. Child abuse registry checks, report four. And the Wilkes Avenue alignment to William R. Clement Parkway extension. Report 5 under Infrastructure Renewal and Public Works, report dated October 31st, 2017.
Thank you. Welcome, Councillor.
Thank you, Mayor and Council colleagues. lot of reports. I'm not going to spend too much time on some of them, but report one, I'm pleased to see that the administration has worked out means in a way to assist cemeteries that actually have churches on them, but are at least have at least 80% of the area of the property dedicated to cemeteries. So I really thank the administration for coming through on that. Item two, I wanted to just mention, I'm not speaking on behalf of the police board, that is not my role, but as a counselor who has been quite interested in the police board and its functioning since before it was actually created, I wanted to just say that I think that the amendment that was proposed by Councillor Mays is fine. It's a good thing, and so it's looking good for that. So I just wanted to mention. Report item four, I was unable to get a hold of, there's a woman who works with the Action Daycare on Dufferin. And she pointed out to me and brought to my attention one reality in that while we have our employees are working with kids at various different programs and different means, they are subject to a certain kind of check, but a vulnerable person's check. Now that is not subject to a child abuse registry check. Now, there is a difference between the two registries. I researched it because I wasn't sure on the grounds, but I did check. And provincially, there are two separate offices that deal with maintaining databases and information in regards to the vulnerable persons, and then also in terms of child abuse. They do not share data back and forth between each other. And so in daycares and various places, when you're working with kids, it is essential to have that child abuse registry as well done. I'm not going to go into all the details, but so what the motion that was brought through the Lord Selkirk West Donan Community Committee is to look at having our employees who are working directly with kids to be going through a child abuse registry check as well. And it also goes a bit further on to often a number of programs that are endorsed or facilitated through our city people. We'll also have volunteers. You may have some senior volunteers who are in a program with kids, which are really, they're good programs. It is also asking that a child abuse registry be considered for that as well when volunteers are working with kids as well in those terms. Criminal record check isn't quite enough, right? So I'll leave that with you. We'll leave, I guess, that to the administration to figure out. Item number the alignment. I want to spend a bit of time on this. Yeah, item five of the infrastructure renewal and public works. So you all see my email and my response. I've been watching this. Now, the Inner Ring Road, its alignment and is very similar to our rapid transit plan and alignment of various routes. And for me, I'm quite concerned about this motion that was moved at the infrastructure renewal and public works and quite not very happy about Mr. McNeil saying that option four is no longer on the table. And this motion here is to stay with the Wilkes alignment, which has maybe three options, whatever it is. Now, when we did the stage two rapid transit route, there was three options. The councillors for the area, Councillor Swandell and Councillor Orlico, did not agree with the alignment that ended up going ahead. Did not agree. And actually, Mayor, the population in the area did not agree with that. There were no millionaires involved in this particular situation, lobbying to block this. Okay? So for me, I don't know why we're not using the same process with the Inner Ring Road and its alignment with the William Clement Parkway. All options should be not taken off the table. We need to go with the route that offers the best functionality and the best value for the taxpayers at all levels, because these projects are ultimately funded by all three levels of government. And so to take something off the table and not have proper costing, functionality investigations and so on with these other three options so that we can compare it and as council make a proper decision. I'm not willing to make a decision. I think this is erroneous to be moving this motion at this time, because I believe that we need to know what the costing, what the realities are with these other options as well. And then council can make a decision. That's how we made a decision with the Stage 2 Rapid Transit Corridor, the Southwest Rapid Transit Corridor. And I think that we owe the citizens proper due diligence to make decisions in that manner, not in the manner that this thing's going down now. I also want to point out something. Administration is going about doing a bunch of things, but I don't hear an outcry about administration just deciding that they're going to take away green space from the north end at the old exhibition grounds. We have no millionaires to mount a fight to stop the stealing of green space, right? We don't. And that's what's happening there. That is what's happening. So, you know, I think the decision-making process here is failed. And it just upsets me to hear this stuff. And then in the meantime, you know, it doesn't matter about the North End, does it? Really, really irks me, and it really upsets me. I want to be able, and the Inner Ring Road is a citywide decision to make. And so every councillor on council needs to have the proper information before we make a decision. And I just want to leave it, this motion from Councillor Morantz is erroneous, and just because one city councillor is opposed to it, which Councillor Orlico, Councillor Swandell, were opposed to the route that we went with Stage 2 Southwest Rapid Transit. Why didn't we go with them? The population there wanted it to go somewhere else. I leave it at that. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor. Have a great day.
Okay. Next delegation. We have George Frazier, Executive Director of Historic Kildonan Church, Presbyterian and Cemetery, Inc., to be heard with respect to the religious or not-for-profit cemetery's frontage levy exemption.
Followed by Mr. Jim Baker.
Also on the same subject of Elmwood Cemetery.
Morning, Mr. Frazier. Welcome.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of Executive Policy Committee, Administration. This marks a historic day, too, for me, personally. Sixth appearance on this issue over the last 3 years. And, of course, I'm here on behalf of Historic Kildonan, the original Presbyterian Cemetery at Frog Plain, 1851. And it exceeds the ceremonial moment you just outlined, Mr. Mayor. I'll be as quick as I can and direct attention to the actual bylaw. And we've been able to, at our meeting that we held, and we thank Mel Chambers is up here, and we finally, in the 3 years, had a chance to sit down face-to-face and with other representatives from other cemeteries, and we resolved in principle the whole issue in about 45 minutes. So what was contentious previously was the fact that we did not have an identification of the roll numbers or the properties in question, and that's on the very last page of the appendix of the bylaw. And you'll have to, if you want to find out who they are, you'll have to Google and find out exactly who they are. But I know Councillor Gillingham is very aware of St. James Anglican across from Polo Park. Margaret Steele is very pleased with this, and she attended the meeting. We have our property in place. The delegation behind me will speak to it, speak to their situation. And we have the Roman Catholic Archdiocese, and we have the Jewish cemeteries also identified here very clearly, too. So, in essence, what this does is it creates perhaps a future process. It's an exemption list to which other new properties, if that ever was to occur in the future, could be added, or properties could be deleted from the base report. We also had concerns about historic properties where there are worshiping congregations. St. John's Anglican would be an example. The Basilica in St. Boniface would be another. And the St. Charles Parish in the very west end of the city would be another leading example of that. Plus the historic properties where there are historic churches that are no longer used for worship, but are there by historical designation. So that created an additional three properties that came onto the total exemption list. And so the 80-20 rule, which has been outlined here, I think is fair. And all of the feedback I've got from cemetery volunteers at cemetery operations agree with that. So it gives some latitude into the future for exemptions of current properties and for even removal if those things were to change. So we would like to certainly thank the administration for having a nice meeting with us. The coffee was great. The conversation was encouraging. Jane Saxby, who heads up the city cemeteries, was also in the room, and we have agreement to continue to meet on other matters that are operationally oriented into the future. So all in all, after 3 years, some level of frustration from our perspectives, I would like to say I think we're heading, excuse me, in the right direction. So I'll just end my comments there, Mr. Mayor, unless you want me to talk about the Wilkes extension. I can add history to that, too.
You want an honest answer? You know, I'll just say thanks very much for the dialogue. You have been very patient and appreciate the collaboration with public service and ultimately with members of council. And I just want to say thank you very much. Took a little bit of time, but I think we're in a much better place from as a result of the dialogue.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Good morning, Mr. Baker. Welcome.
Good morning, Mayor and Councillors.
Nice to see you.
George Fraser really outlined what I have to say. The only thing is when Nelma Cemetery identified this issue and I had past experience with George as a councillor, I said there's the person that should be heading this up. So I have to thank George for making this happen. We were very pleased to see administration taking information from the operators, interested parties, and of course, at the very end of the process, that facilitated something that we think is very, very workable. So I'm here to thank an administration for doing that and EPC and council for moving it along. So we at Elma Cemetery, Historic Elma Cemetery, support it. One of the things when I was just walking here to the council, I walked by three photos, not photos, art, paintings of mayors that are interred at Elma Cemetery, amongst other councillors, dignitaries, and every walks of life. So cemeteries are forever, and when a bylaw like this is created, I'm glad to see that there's some flexibility in it because things do change. The operations of cemeteries are a lot different now than they were in 1902 when Elman Cemetery was created as a private company. And just to emphasize that one of the reasons why this is so important is Elma Cemetery was virtually a bankrupt business in 1996, and it was the city and the province along with the volunteers who have resurrected the viability of that property. And now that I have an audience here too, yes, there is still lots of space at Elmwood Cemetery. It's not closed. And the office is no longer on Henderson Highway, or Kelvin, as when I grew up in Elmwood it was called. We're now on Hesper Avenue. So thanks very much for all those who participated, Mr. Mayor and councillors, and of course the administration. Any questions?
Not hearing any questions. Thanks.
Thank you.
Next allegation is registered. We have a group that wants to appear with respect to the Wilkes Avenue alignment to William R. Clement Parkway extension. First have Paula Havixbeck, followed by Brett Ferguson, Lori Doby, Darla Reddy, and then Garth Steak.
Good morning and welcome. You found the place okay?
Pardon me?
I see you found the place okay.
I found it okay.
Welcome back to City Hall. It's nice to see you.
Good morning and thank you for having us. We have a number of exhibits, and the first exhibits, 1 to 4, we are speaking to all of us, among all four of us, and then exhibits 5, 6, 7 are the next pile of 3, and I'll be speaking to those. We'll hand them out as each speaker comes forward. First four.
And just for clarity, so there's who in your group is speaking as? You have 4?
Pardon me?
I'm just wondering how many delegations you have in your group.
We have 4.
Okay.
And we'll sort of answer some questions and present in tandem.
Sounds good.
Okay. Okay. This motion needs to pass today unanimously. That's my hope. And we are going to answer every possible argument that you could have for why you wouldn't support it. I'm probably the one person in this room that has been with this file since it started. I attended all of the consultations in the traffic study that was done by MMM during 2012-2011, and I attended all of the consultations and the meetings that were held in the planning of Precinct Q, which is Ridgewood South, which is north of Wilkes. And that occurred from 2010 to 2013. We have a bit of a timeline, and we're all going to be referencing this timeline. You have it as a handout. I'm not going to go through it. You can read some of the key dates that we've picked out. But I would first like to tell you that the support is growing for this in the community every day. We have resubmitted the petition, and we've done that because you will note in your online version that the addresses have been redacted. And so I want you to see the addresses, because that's really important. Because I know, sitting on that side, that when you get a petition for a neighborhood like this, you get people from Linden Woods or St. James or somewhere else in the city. If you look at those addresses, they are all from Liberty, Loudoun, Howe, McConnell, Wilkes, McCreary. All those streets are directly impacted. That's hugely significant. I also want to speak to the number of people that have shown up here today, as well the association that has formed that has over 200 households now. So more than one person per household is joining the association. We have submitted the petition, which has around 300 names on it. That's significant. So all of these people here want the twinning of Wilkes and are supportive of that. And some key dates and some key things I'm going to present will support Councillor Morantz's motion, and you will see why you absolutely need to support this motion. Absolutely. I'm going to talk about the road alignment that we all know of, and I'm going to refer to it as option 4. So option 4 is the one that cuts through the neighborhood. This was the only road alignment submitted. I have the environmental impact report. I've read it. The city only sent one road to the province for analysis. So that's not the road that we're asking for today. We're asking that the city look at the actual road that it was set up to analyze. In December 2014, you all authorized consultants double their money. So up to $1.6 million. You awarded the department another $800,000 to go out and do this study. And it was to, the exact wording was to have design alternatives for the extension, not to have one option go, alternatives. So if they're only analyzing one road, I would argue that that became a fait accompli. That piece of paper was signed off by the department in the summer, June of 2016. So why is that significant? Well, if you go back and look at the timeline, there was consultations in January 2016, and there was consultations as recently as September and October of 2017, presenting three other options other than the one that already had detailed drawings, and it's a 300-page report showing detailed drawings of a road alignment that wasn't even one of the ones you would be considering in your in voting on this. It's historically always been known that Wilkes would be the route that would be twinned and would be the east-west corridor. In addition to the regular petition in support of the Wilkes twinning, we went out in the last 48 hours to the Wilkes residents, the businesses in the community, and we have about half supporting. And it's in your map with the green blocks. So we got them to sign another petition that says, I live on Wilkes and I support this. And that's hugely significant because we've done the department's consultation in going out and saying, you know, what do you think of this? We haven't finished because there's people away, obviously, and can't reach everyone. But I think that's hugely significant. We heard that argument on Monday from a councillor and we addressed that and went out and tried to look at it. There are many significant issues with this environmental report, and I'm just going to highlight a couple of them. Although it was supposed to look at the environmental impact of a road that was going through South Wilkes area, it relied heavily on all of the environmental and natural lands assessments that were collected and all of those reports that were collected in the work on the precinct north of Wilkes. They simply blanketed it and said all of these same issues would be there with whatever flora, fauna, animals, reptiles, all of those things. There are four precincts in this area, O, M, N, and P. It's an area 10 times the size that they looked at in the natural lands assessment. That's hugely significant to not have spent much effort or time in that immediate area. The conclusion of that environmental impact assessment report is what's most startling. That the project is not, I quote right from the report, that the project is not anticipated to result in any significant adverse effects with the exception of potential impacts to white-tailed deer and human health from deer vehicle collisions. That's in the conclusion. Wilkes, Grant, Roblin, all have extremely high numbers, probably the most high numbers of deer vehicle collisions in the city. And now you would be adding another route that would create more harm than good by having an additional road in the same area where there's a high concentration of deer population. There's one big issue with land use that I want to talk about and process. All we have talked about, all we have heard about in the media is roadways. A road. We're planning a road in a neighborhood. Where is anything about how the land will be used? There's four precincts, as I said, in this area. 6,000 acres. To put it into perspective, Ridgewood South was 600 to 800 developable acres. That's an area 10 times the amount. And we have not initiated any work with the planning department. No, wait, the planning department was involved. They sent the realty people to tell the people at the consultations how much their properties would be to be expropriated. That's the only touch on this file that I can see that's been made by the planning department. They have not brought into the fold. There's been no area impact report. There's been no consultation in that regard. We all know, councillors, that planning the roadworks doesn't work in isolation from planning the land use. You don't know where the residential areas will be. You don't know where commercial nodes will be. You haven't considered green space, community centers, anything like that, but you're putting a road right in the middle of the neighborhood. This makes no sense. Now, I leave you with the question because it's nagging at me. How could we put the road in? Is it a fait accompli as well? Has this land been determined for its use already? And have this roadway system been already predetermined? And you're going to hear from some of our experts in the area who will provide more answers to some of the questions that we've been hearing in the media. Pass this motion today, please, unanimously. This motion gives your administration the option to go back. I've said every report, if you got a report today on this from the administration, it would show you one option. This motion gives your administration, and Doug McNeil, CAO Doug McNeil, at the Public Works meeting last week said he is not, his hands are not tied. You can ask him that again. His hands are not tied. He will create options for what Wilkes could look like. I think that's fair. And I don't think that that pigeonholes the department into coming back with one option. You already just have one option. If they wrote an admin report today, that's all it could say. This is a large mess that needs cleaning up. There's so many messes on this file. That's for you to deal with. But I guarantee you, if this was happening in St. James, or this was happening in River Heights, or this was happening in St. Vitale, or Wolseley, or Point Douglas, and your residents were this upset, you'd be doing something. You'd be exactly where Councillor Morantz is, and you would want his support. Thank you.
Thank you very much. You have others in the delegation?
Yes. So we can take questions at the end because we have quite a bit of information.
Do you guys want any questions now, or do you just want to wait to go? We'll just proceed? Okay. We have Mr. Ferguson up next. Welcome.
Good morning. I'm Brett Ferguson from BW Ferguson and Associates. Just to give you a bit of background, I was approached by Ms. Reddy from Pitt Blado on behalf of the South Wilkes Property Owners Association, I think their name is, about a month ago, with the request to provide some consultation on the potential costs associated with an alternative alignment to the option four, which has been discussed. The alternative would be the Wilkes alignment, the twinning of Wilkes. At the time that they approached me, they didn't realize that I had led a team with the company I previously worked with at Stevenson Real Estate. I had led the team that consulted with MMM, now WSP, to determine the property acquisition costs associated with the option four development. So that report it stands on its own. It's a little bit different than what we're doing here, and I'll go into some brief detail on that. Just in terms of my background, this isn't the first of this type of assignment I've been involved with. I routinely work with the engineering firm Stantec, Dillon, MMM, WSP. We did the just a few sample projects, South Rapid Transit Corridor, Phase 2, property acquisition costs. A number of years ago, we did the Keniston widening before that whole project got shut down with Capion. We did the Marion Street with MMM widening that I guess was a fail, and a number of similar projects. So this, you know, this is really in the area of expertise that I have, that we've exhibited in the past. So what I suggested is, because when we were engaged to do the option four alignment, the property acquisition costs, that was Q4 of 2015, extended into Q1, Q2 of 2016. I suggested that we update that information to today so we could have an equal comparison between what I was suggesting acquisition costs would be today for Wilkes versus the option four. Second thing, if I could just get you to go, The map is, it's such a small scale, I apologize. But what I suggest that would be reasonable is to only analyze the area of the alignment where there's a divergence between the two options. That's option four and the Wilkes twinning. So what I suggested was reasonable is cut it off around Charleswood Road, Municipal Road to be exact, where the alignments diverge from Wilkes, and then also at McCreary Road. And just focus on that, the area south of Wilkes, because north of Wilkes, the William Clement or the Moray Street extension, most of that land is owned by the City of Winnipeg. There's a handful of properties, Haney Street and things like that, but those would be common to any project. So what we did was strip out all the takings north of Wilkes and west of Charleswood Road, Municipal Road, anything east of McCreary. So we're dealing with a smaller set of properties, but in essence, if you want to just go to the next slide, this might be a little better because it's at a better scale. This is west of the Clement extension where it would meet Wilkes. So you see the area shaded in yellow is the original option four alignment. What I've tried to do is bounded in red is determine the property that would be required for an 80-meter right-of-way for development of the Wilkes twinning and widening. And if you go to the next slide, please. This is just a continuation east of the intersection of Clement Parkway and Wilkes. So again, you can see the red bounded area, which would represent my estimated twinning area. There's nothing engineered here. There's no GIS behind it. It's really my estimation of what that 80-meter right-of-way would entail in terms of property requirements. So the analysis that the report that you have in front of you, this basically summarizes the information presented. In the original work for WSP, the option four alignment, originally there was 90 properties required. Property acquisitions, now that's either through a full taking, the entire property, or through a partial taking. The main difference is when you just take a part of a property, then you're open for compensation for injurious affection. So that's a significant factor. In this reduced area that we looked at, that I showed you, for the option four, there is 73 properties required now on my estimate. 62 of those being partial takings, 45 properties required for the Wilkes twinning area, 31 partial takings. So the estimated acquisition costs, about $21.6 million, and this is real estate only, has nothing to do with development of the road, construction costs, engineering costs associated with the right-of-way development. $21.6 million for the option four versus approximately $12 million for the Wilkes widening. Injurious affection is the significant number there due to the number of partial takings on the option four alignment. We estimate about $4.7 million with an additional about $850,000 of compensation, which in my opinion would be, it would be most likely that there would be residents in this neighborhood area with option four, even though they wouldn't have had a taking of their property. I think they probably would make a claim for injurious affection. If you run a 4 to 6 lane highway through any neighborhood, if your property isn't taken, I'm sure that you're going to have some opposition to the noise, nuisance, and the change of your neighborhood composition. So those are my estimates. Be happy to address any questions.
Thank you very much. Councillor Moretz.
Thank you, Mr. Ferguson. I just want to clarify, did you say that you did this consulting work on this project for WSP?
We were originally engaged by WSP at the end of 2015 as part of the functional design process. Typically, they would get an appraisal company or consulting company to estimate the costs of the land acquisitions at that point.
So the numbers on this page two of your report, were these numbers that were given to WSP to assist them in?
No, like I said, these numbers, because it was a different set of properties, it's a smaller number of properties, and also I've taken the numbers and updated them to 2017, to November 2017 estimates.
Well, you've seen the WSP estimates on Rogue 4 and the option 1. Are they, those estimates that have been put out, are they consistent with the advice that you gave them when you were retained by them?
I don't know. My numbers would be, again, it's just one variable in the costs. My numbers only deal with the real estate acquisition costs.
Okay.
Obviously, the construction costs are of a much larger magnitude.
Okay. Thank you.
Councillor Olicko.
Thank you very much, and interesting to hear a little bit of the history. And thank you for all the work. Just to get my head around, because this option 4, this is all brand new to us, too. That wasn't one of the things we talked about. But so did you do any work for options 1, 2, or 3, though?
No, when we were engaged by, it was MMM at the time, but yeah. WSP, we were only asked to provide the estimates for the one option. That being what's called option 4 today.
Okay, thank you.
Sorry. I want to ask the same question and just have you repeat your answer. Just to say that again. You were...
Oh, when we were engaged by MMM...
What were you engaged to do? Exactly.
Yeah, we were only asked to provide the estimates for the one alignment option. It wasn't an option at that time. That was the functional design that we were given.
Thank you.
Councillor Gillingham.
Thank you for your presentation and for this information. So just to be crystal clear, the information you've provided us today is information that has been done now for the group that is here today?
That's right.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you.
I'm going to briefly pass the chair to Councillor Pagetan.
Another delegation?
Yep. Next delegation that we have is Ms. Laurie Dobie. Yeah, that's fine.
Good morning, Ms. Dobie.
Okay. Do you want me to start now?
Yeah.
Okay. My name's Laurie Dobie. I'm a resident of Loudon Road in the South Wilkes area. I'm also vice president of the South Wilkes Community Association. I'm speaking, obviously, in support of widening Wilkes. And by the way, I want to point out, I'm not a millionaire. Neither are many of my neighbors. Unlike Andrew Marquess and Sandy Schindelman, who may have lobbied in favor of the rapid transit motion. As you've heard, the option number 4 route was never presented to the public until September of this year, even though it was first shown to Paula Havixbeck in around 2012 and was actively pursued by the Public Works Department and its consultants at WSP since December 2014. Despite that, the route was never mentioned in public consultations held on January 19, 2016. During the time since that route was being pursued, many residents of the area have applied for building permits for renovations, new construction, outbuildings, and whatnot in the area without being told that that option 4 was a possibility or that there was a chance of their property being expropriated. And I would argue that the issuance of the building permits to these new homeowners and renovations to existing homeowners show that the city has been supportive of this kind of rural residential development in this area. The residents of this community have chosen to live here because it's a unique community. It's one of the only communities in the city where you can find rural residential, partially agricultural, large lot community setting. And we live in this area despite the fact that we pay a large cost for things that are otherwise provided as city services throughout the rest of the city, like trucking in our water, having our septic tanks pumped out. We still pay very high taxes. But we do all this because it's a unique community that people want to live in. And that's what brings value to our homes. Obviously, a four-lane highway right through the center of the neighborhood would completely change the character of the area, and it would result in huge claims for compensation, as you've heard earlier today. We do recognize, though, that an east-west connection of Sterling Lyon Parkway to the proposed William Clement Parkway is probably necessary at some point. We would just say that there's an option that makes a lot more sense. Clearly, using the existing route east-west through Wilkes makes a lot more sense. And contrary to some of the reports we've heard earlier, it may even be less expensive, because the range of figures that you were given by this CAO and were reported in the media are an extremely broad range. And if you look at the lower end of that range, it's pretty clear that the costs are actually cheaper for the Wilkes expansion. So I think there's been a bit of a misrepresentation about those figures in the media. Property owners along Wilkes have also known for decades that expansion of that road was likely. And there are, as you've seen today, we've got some who are willing to attest to the fact that they would prefer to have that route, even though it expropriates some of their property. And some of them are even looking forward to it. The same is not true of the residents of the Wilkes South area. Part of the goal in an expropriation proceeding is to make people whole when you've taken their property. But I would say that it's impossible to make whole the residents of this area, because there is no other community where we can move to, where we can have that large lot rural residential setting, at least certainly not within the city limits and at the south end, the southwest end of the city where our families are growing up. On the other hand, along Wilkes, at least six of the owners of the property that is being expropriated are commercial owners who can easily find similar comparable property at this end of the city. Something I'd also like to point out is that there's one mysterious owner who would stand an awful lot to gain from this road being proposed by WSP. I just want to refer you to the map. I'm not sure if you can see the area that's outlined in blue. I try with my mouse. We don't have a pointer. That area is owned by a company called Acro Enterprises, Ltd. It was acquired from Qualico in 2007. It's a huge area of undeveloped land, about 1,550 acres. The only information that you can find on the public record about who owns that company is that it's owned by a prominent tax lawyer in the city, Cy Fine. He's the sole director, shareholder, and officer of that property. Clearly, a tax lawyer has probably no use for a large area of undeveloped property like that. And I'd say that it's highly likely that he owns the property in trust for a developer. Developers sometimes do that so that their name won't be discernible in public searches. They just don't want people to know what their future plans are for development in the area. And in this case, you'll see that there's a fairly reasonable reason for them to do that. It's not surprising that a prominent developer has been in the news recently speaking in support of the road through our neighborhood, the Option 4 road. That road, shown in yellow there, would
speak into the microphone.
Sorry, it doesn't. Can you outline this part?
Yeah.
This area that Paul is trying to outline with the mouse, that whole area would have to be expropriated if the Option 4 road was done, and that's a fairly substantial section of property. And guess who would get the expropriation money from that? It would be Acro Enterprises. So they would have a huge chunk of change in their pockets from the expropriation claim. And in addition, there'd be a road giving access to the area, west or south, below that, that area, which they could then develop and put houses on. So they're getting an expropriation money for the property that they're cutting off there that's basically unusable. They're getting an access road put in by the city, and they're getting some city infrastructure like hydro and whatnot in that area. If they were to develop that land now with no road there, they'd be paying for those things, and they wouldn't be, or at least a certain percentage of that they'd be paying for, and they wouldn't be getting the money from that expropriation claim. We do want to say, though, that I don't think that the members of our community association are opposed to development. We do recognize that there are large areas of land that are undeveloped in the area, and development of residential neighborhoods of any sort is certainly nothing that we're opposed to. It's just that it should not be done at the taxpayers' expense, and it should not be done running a road through an existing neighborhood. It's also been said by a certain developer in the media that the city should never have permitted that large lot rural residential development in the area. Well, that development has happened. It's been done legally with your support, and it's an established community. Great cities recognize that large lot rural residential neighborhoods like these are part of a diverse city, despite what might be in the interests of large developers. We're putting our trust in you to support this motion and help us preserve our unique neighborhood. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Mays?
Thank you for the presentation. I know little about your neighborhood. I am inclined to follow Councillor Morantz's lead on this. I just can't, having spent many, many, many hours in this job with the people south of the perimeter in my ward where I'm on large residential lots, I can't let the word unique go by. So there are other areas of the city that are not on city water and sewer. They do get police, fire, ambulance, snow clearing, mm-hmm. garbage, recycle. I have had this debate many times with
right.
With
not too many that have horses on the street and stables and that sort of thing.
Yeah, no, and you don't pay the frontage levy because you don't have the city water and sewer, but you do pay property taxes. I have worked with former Councillor Havlicek and Councillor Morantz to try and increase the minimum municipal services grant that each household gets. So these two are certainly aware of the situation out there. So I don't want to minimize your issues, and I'm certainly not firsthand familiar with your area, and I'm looking to Councillor Morantz's lead here. I wouldn't want there to be coverage of this saying, well, this is the only neighborhood in the whole city like this. There really are some others. This, I think, is the second biggest I happen to represent. The biggest, and what I've learned over my 6 years is, yeah, there are some unique issues, gravel roads, lack of water and sewer, that the people are still in the city sometimes. They feel they're forgotten, and that's a fair comment. So
right.
I appreciate your issues. Maybe spent more time on this than I ever dreamed I would on these sort of larger parcels of land. But thank you for the presentation.
Thanks.
I think there's a few other questions for you. Councillor Rantz.
Thank you, Ms. Dobie, for your presentation. It goes without saying that I am 100% with you and members of this community. I just want to ask... in terms of this stretch of road here in the blue box
mm-hmm.
That is owned by Acro, do you know what amount of land that is that would need to be expropriated?
Unfortunately, I don't. I don't know if Brett, you don't have that information. I don't have the amount. Don't know.
Okay.
I mean, you can see on the map, but I can't tell you what the acreage of that area is. It would be the part under the, you know, if you see on the map in the outlined area in blue, it would be the part from Wilkes Avenue to the other side of that yellow road.
Okay. Perhaps Mr. Ferguson has a more
right, as opposed to the area just between the red line and the road,
yeah.
If it was the Wilkes expansion.
We could certainly determine those numbers. Mm-hmm. We've got the acreages for all of the parcels. You can see the legal lines that... mm-hmm. go north-south, so it would be an assemblage of those acreages.
Do you know, have an idea what the value for that Acro roadway would be in an expropriation?
Again, I'd have to break it out. It's reported in numerous parcels here.
But, I mean, the land value for that area, if it was earmarked by a developer for residential development, it would be based on the highest and best use of that property, which would be a residential development. So it would be a pretty substantial number based on the principles behind expropriation claims.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay. Anything else? Yes.
We're going through a couple of expropriation. That's not actually totally accurate on how the expropriations work. It's as the land is at the time, it's supposed to be in the future.
Well, so, we have a lawyer here who can tell you.
Again, I just
an expropriation.
Well, again, we'll battle that. That's my understanding. I'm not debating you on it. I've had this filed a number of times, and we have a couple of expropriations going on now. Mm-hmm. That the city is understanding, and I guess if we have lawyers, we'd say the other. That's why we have lawyers. Okay. I'd battle back. But again, I'm not disputing your point at all. I just want to clarify that.
Okay.
I appreciate all the materials that each of you provided. I'm going to read through them in detail. This question of Acro Enterprises, which, just for clarity, and I apologize, I had to step away for a moment while you were beginning your remarks. But what you're saying is, based on your searches, Acro Enterprises currently owns the land. Mm-hmm. But they were acquired from Qualico in 2007. I believe an employee or representative from Qualico has been providing.
Yes, I didn't want to mention that because obviously we don't want to reveal our source. So it's more than speculation on my part.
Okay, thank you. And but you're not aware. I mean, you're saying the registered or public search. Maybe you can clarify.
Okay, a public
that
search
obviously is
right. A public search in the land. The land titles office will show you only the registered owner, which cannot be a trust. Land titles in Manitoba does not recognize trusts. So if there was a trust, that would not show on the title. When you do the corporate registration, you name your director, officer, and shareholder. And again, the legal owner of the shares is Cy Fine, the tax lawyer. But you don't have to show that he holds them in trust under a trust agreement that's separate. So those things would not show on any public search.
And how big is that property? Like in the blue, it is. I mean, we can see the
15. That is the whole parcel is 1,550 acres.
Okay, so it's pretty substantive.
Right, and we don't know. There are other parcels in the area that are owned by numbered companies that we didn't investigate. There could be much more of that sort of property. This is just the one that came to our attention.
Okay. Thanks very much.
Thanks.
Next delegation, Darla Reddy, legal counsel for South Wilkes Community Association.
Good morning and welcome.
Good morning, Mayor, councillors. Wow. This is, there's even more information that's come to pass from what you've been presented so far this morning. So let's speak to a little bit of new information we have that we can now add to the timeline. So you were just told by Brett Ferguson that he was retained by WSP in the fall of 2015. So let's position that on the timeline that you've already seen. So that means that around the time that WSP was speaking to stakeholders, not the public, but stakeholder groups, that they were also commissioning evaluation from an expert valuator on the expropriation costs, not of one, two, or three, but of a wholly different plan being option four. So I want you to think about something in terms of your deliberations today and what's happened here as far as process goes, is that at the same before, so in the fall of 2005, an expropriation expert gets a plan, only one plan, to cost. And January 19th, 2016, after that assignment has already been tendered, we have the citizens of Winnipeg at a public hearing being offered option one, two, and three, not option four. No even identification of option four. So how does that happen? when you have internally a process by which you are using citizens' money for $1.3 million to go out, and that doesn't include necessarily the costs of Mr. Ferguson's report. I have no idea whether that was encompassed in the MMM costing. But you clearly have a bait and switch situation here. It's absolutely evident on the record from the evidence that you've been presented. You cannot give sort of one option to an evaluator and say this is the proposed option, and then months later present three other options to residents and not even speak to option four. So what's happened here before you is the reaction to what's happened. This is action, reaction in process. Is that the 300-some residents that have signed the petition, the individual property owners along Wilkes, by the way, they're not the individual property owners that have just unbettered farmland. They are the property owners that have built houses along Wilkes, are in support of the twinning of Wilkes. So this is not a few disgruntled homeowners, as being reported through the records produced by Public Works and the reports and in the media. It's offensive to say that 300-some petition holders from the immediate area are a few disgruntled homeowners. That's not the reality here. And it behooves everybody in the city, administration and otherwise, to make sure the record is set straight on the scope of support for the twinning of Wilkes, which, by the way, we look back at this record, and as of November 2012, you have MMM Group itself giving advice to the city that the twinning of Wilkes has to be on the radar based on traffic volumes that are occurring north of Wilkes. So in response to traffic problems north of Wilkes, you heard earlier today Paula say, I commissioned a report. I commissioned to sit down with MMM and city planners to say, how are we going to deal with north of Wilkes traffic issues? And as part of that, you have MMM saying, there's a likelihood we're going to have to twin Wilkes, and it will impact 43 properties on Wilkes, which, by the way, is very similar to what you've heard from Mr. Ferguson today. We're talking about 45 properties. So you can pretty much be assured that that data is credible. You have a credible market valuator, and you have MMM producing virtually the same information back in 2012. So let's look forward at what MMM told you in 2012. And they told this to the Assiniboine Community Committee that received a copy of their report. The estimated construction costs for Wilkes at the time were $36.4 million. That's for road drainage and illumination costs. So it's not like there is no evidence before council that you've got some preliminary estimations as to cost for twinning Wilkes at that point. So that was way back in 2012. So let's speak a little bit now about what's happened to date. As I want to just point you to a few of the pieces of information that Brett Ferguson shared and address directly the comments made by the previous councillor, because he's right. No information should, council should not be making decisions in a vacuum. And if so far to date what you've heard is that the cost involved with twinning Wilkes will be substantially more than the costs related to option four. That's on the record. That was reported to the media. We don't have the background information that supports those assertions, and we leave it to you as a council to do your due diligence to find out what supported those comments that were made to you apparently within the last few days that basically compared and contrasted costs related to expropriation and build costs for Wilkes versus option four, because it is your job to make sure the public purse is maintained and managed appropriately, prudently, within the construct of the design requirements for transportation, for land use planning, that you have to balance as part of that investigation. But clearly today here, You have evidence presented to you with all of the supporting figures. There's no mystery here. It's delineated property by property, expropriation by expropriation, exactly what those costs would look like in 2017 dollars. You don't it's not back of the napkin type of stuff here, right? So what you have is you have, and let's turn to it again because it's absolutely critical, that the costs for expropriation alone for option four, the recommended, WSP recommended alignment is $21,600,000 and change. The costs for and that involves 73 properties. So where your CAO got information related to this only involves 43 properties, we don't know. We leave that to you. But a credible calculation based on real data by an expert shows it involves 73 registered property holders for $71.6 million. That's baseline expropriation. That's not including expropriation costs that will be borne based on injurious affection to related property holders, maybe in a wider circle. And getting back to what Ms. Dobie was saying, that does not include economic loss damages, which are ahead of damage under the Expropriation Act, that will be very, very substantial in this instance. If you go back to that map, we're talking about a 1,550 parcel that we certainly have reason to believe is slated for development over time. So if you take a chunk of that, so it's non-developable, you have an economic loss that is not factored into this. That actually will be quite significant. And as Mr. Ferguson said, he can get you the amount of the actual the footprint of that piece of land, but that does not include what costs you and the city will have to bear for loss of economic opportunity related to a development project that's been on the books where land parcels are being accumulated at least since 2007. So that's not even in these numbers, and that's what we're trying to get across to you. So let's look at the twinning of Wilkes. So the twinning of Wilkes involves 45 properties. So even if you say between 43 and 45, based on what M&M is saying back in 2012 to now, we are basically in line with two property differential. I don't know exactly what the complete footprints were of the M&M design, but we know what these ones are. So it's $12 million in expropriation costs. So right then and there, there's a huge and significant and misrepresentation, we believe, to this committee as well as to the media on what the actual costs are. So this is not a few disgruntled people. These are people that lived in the community that basically support the twinning of Wilkes. You have no information that's being provided to you in the report that's being done by WSP relating to the costs for twinning Wilkes, because it's out. You're only getting information relating to the costs for the proposal being option four. That's it. So waiting for a report that gives you no information, how is that helpful? So again, importantly, your own CAO has said by looking...
Are you able to wrap up shortly?
Yes, I am.
Okay.
Your own CAO has indicated there is no issue with narrowing the focus at this point on Wilkes. He had indicated his people, and his people agreed. They nodded. We saw them on the 4th or the 31st of October nodding, saying, yeah, we can come back with particular proposals involved focusing on the twinning of Wilkes. We'll let you know what they are. If there are any issues, that will be presented to council, and council consider what a prudent approach is at that point. This motion is directing your own administration to look at and focus on Wilkes. That's what this motion is all about. You have been provided with a legal submission that details some of the facts and other issues involving expropriation matters, but I'll leave that to you for your consideration. But the association wishes a unanimous support from EPC, understanding how this has happened, that is the appropriate approach. It respects transportation planning, it respects the cost issues, and ought to be investigated in its absolute fullest and reported back to this council so that it can make prudent decisions.
Thank you.
Thank you for your time.
I appreciate the input today. I will just say that we'll let our CAO speak for himself.
Absolutely.
And so, but do appreciate your input here today, Councillor Gillingham.
Thank you very much for your presentation. Yes, there's a lot of information. There's quite the timeline on this, and I think former Councillor Havixbeck, she's got it right. Large mass is your words, I think, and so trying to sort through all this. Just help me understand. I'm not making comment on one route versus the other, just trying to understand the timeline. Did you indicate that in October or November of 2012, MMM stated that Wilkes would have to be widened? Is that what you said?
Yes, that was in their November 2012 MMM's report to the Assiniboine Community Committee meeting of December 4th, 2012. So that was attached, and it's on the public record.
Yeah, I have that. I've read through that. Thank you.
Okay.
I guess I'm just wondering how that squares with, to your knowledge, just asking you for your knowledge, that, you know, I'm holding, you know, the Charleswood Area Transportation Study October 12, 2012 presentation that was, you know, that I know probably many attended. I think it was at the church, if I believe the United Church, I think. And the recommendation there from MMM, and I'm just, again, I wasn't there, so I'm trying to figure out how this, where it came down. The recommendation was there in bold, is therefore recommended that Wilkes Avenue not be widened along its existing alignment, and that an alternate east-west arterial south of Wilkes Avenue is recommended to service the Charleswood area. So, and even in the report that you cite, it also talks about an alternate east-west arterial roadway south of Wilkes be examined. So would it be fair to say that both and the examination of both the widening of Wilkes and the roadway south of Wilkes were part of the report and the recommendation?
For the record, I haven't seen the first report that you pointed to, but yes, it is fair to say that MMM Group acknowledged both that there would be a need to widen Wilkes, and they recommended the potential investigation of alternate routes at that point. So what the actual basis for that recommendation was, it was not clear, except for the record, a number of the things that they pointed to that were problematic were the concern for access for property owners along Wilkes if there was a twinning of Wilkes. So what underpinned that recommendation? There's no evidence on the record that we have, except for we can extrapolate that they wanted to see if there was other, they didn't say Wilkes was not possible. There was no evidence to that effect. And absolutely, it's appropriate for the community committees as well as council to have recommended alternatives to be able to weigh.
Thank you. Thanks.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you for your time.
Next delegation, Gerard Steed, also to be heard with respect to the Wilkes Avenue alignment to William R. Clement Parkway extension.
Good morning and welcome back again.
Mr. Mayor, members of the Executive Policy Committee, Mr. McNeil, bureaucrats, representatives of the Charleswood community. This file is an ethical disaster. It's an egregious abuse of process. It's an egregious abuse of power. It's an abrogation of responsibility. And frankly, it has resulted in a crisis of confidence that you're witnessing by the representation here today. Now, I don't know how many of you in Executive Policy Committee have watched the Public Works Committee meeting of October 31, 2017. I watched it at least six times. Some fascinating commentary came out of it. The CAO stated, I'm not happy with what happened here. It was a misstep. It's a lot more than a misstep. It was a trampling of abusive process. Councillor Morantz said, I've lost the confidence. This is a situation where, frankly, my trust is broken. If you listen carefully to the people that came here today, that confidence isn't broken, it's shattered. That's reprehensible. What's so stunning about this entire file? Councillor Morantz is the ward councillor for Charleswood. And I believe, Mr. Mayor, you live in Charleswood. Neither Councillor Morantz, as the chair of Public Works, nor you as the mayor, seem to have known anything about Rogue Route 4. That's despicable that the bureaucracy would do that to you. The total disdain for you. So for those of you on Executive Policy Committee who are watching this, if the bureaucracy will do this to the mayor and to the chair of Public Works, what will they do to you? Better think it over. But most important of all, as a citizen, I watched this thing unfold. You know what? These people are here because they're concerned about their homes. But a home is far more than just a roof and refuge. It's the place where you go to celebrate births and anniversaries and family events. It's also the place where you go to mourn. It's the place where you go to recover and heal from tragedy. And this bureaucracy didn't give a damn about that. They trampled it. How often have we heard about due process? What is due process? Well, due process is fair treatment. Due process is the correct way of doing things for citizens. And so when government harms a person without reason, where the course of law is violated, you're violating due process. So how do you score the administration on due process here? I give them a flat F. Throughout the course of this term, we've heard three things repetitively: openness, transparency, and accountability. Well, what's transparency? Transparency is clarity, but it's also the ability to get information, access information. You brought forward an entirely new proposal, something nobody had ever seen. So how do you score on transparency? An absolute F. Openness. Openness is pretty straightforward. It's being honest and sharing information. The administration never told you about Route 4. They just came forward with it. And then, in the ultimate indignity, informed you how they take your properties. Finally, accountability. What's accountability? Well, the accountability that I believe in is somebody being responsible to stand up and take responsibility for what has happened here. So who's doing it from the administration? I would urge you all to go back and review the Public Works Committee meeting and watch the dance between Mr. McNeil and Councillor Morantz. Where Councillor Morantz said point blank, when are you going to get back to me with the information that was on this file. Well, you know what? There's a due process here. The process is that this has to go to a motion. And once the motion's been completed, then we have to get the Department of Public Engagement involved. But where was the Department of Public Engagement on this file? Did they attend any of these meetings? This motion is going to pass unanimously, as it should. It'll go to council, and it'll pass with a significant majority. But the issue is far greater than this. The issue, Mr. Mayor, is what happened here and why, as was noted. There's only one way to really get to the bottom of it. An independent audit of this file. If you don't do it, and I saw Councillor Morantz today in the paper saying point blank, you know what? I don't think we're ever going to get to the bottom of this because the engineer in this file is now gone. Well, through you, Mr. Mayor, to Councillor Morantz, Councillor Morantz, you should be asking for, not asking, demanding, a list of everybody who has their fingerprints on this file. And when you see who it is, they should be prohibitive from ever dealing with this matter again. This thing won't see the light of day before an election. We all know that. Why an independent audit? Well, it seems to me that the internal audit department here is now looking at a $30 million error and filing a statement of claim. So I guess they're tied up for the next 4 months. I'm going to say something here that I think a lot of you around this table believe. And certainly a lot of the people up here believe there's something far darker here than just going and filing early and not revealing anything. There's something sinister here. Go to an outside auditor. What's the worst that can happen? They can come back and say, you know what? Blew the process. But on the other side of the coin, maybe they can come back and tell you what really happened on this file. Personal commentary. When you find out who's responsible on this file, fire them. And when you fire them, don't give them one of those gold-plated handshakes that this place is notorious for. Think about the suffering, the indignity that these people have had to endure. Put yourself in the same place, members of EPC. Councillor Pachtakhan, if you suddenly got a notification saying your home was gone, how would you react? Councillor Orlico. I'll say this through you, Mr. Mayor, to Mr. McNeil. Just be damn happy this didn't happen in River Heights. Through you, Mr. Mayor, to Councillor Morantz. Somebody has to stand up on this file and show leadership. You're not going to murky the waters by having a motion for an independent audit of this file. Because if you don't, you're going to perpetuate exactly what's happening here now. It's simply stunning to think that the mayor and the CAO, the two pinnacles of power in this particular strong mayor model, knew nothing about what was happening here. We all know somebody knew what was happening here, and it wasn't just an engineer who left the city of Winnipeg. Follow this thing back. Find out what went wrong.
Are you able to wrap up?
Absolutely. Yeah.
An extension of time.
Thank you.
Okay. Two minutes. All in favor? Carried. Thanks. Please continue.
A rhetorical question through you, Mr. Mayor. I might be wrong here. Mr. McNeil, who's the CAO who oversaw this file but doesn't seem to know anything about it, is he the same Mr. McNeil who said that the $30 million problem on the water treatment plant was just a big mistake? I think he is. Do you see a pattern here, councillors? Do you want to continue this pattern? And finally, I think the most important thing that came out of all of this is the vigilance from the people that are here. We're at this meeting at this juncture because of them, not because of executive policy, and God knows not because of the bureaucracy. What happened here is intolerable and unconscionable. In closing, there's one thing we want, and that's the reason I've addressed my comments to you, Councillor Morantz. We want the truth. And contrary to what Jack Nicholson said, we can handle it. Thank you.
Not hearing any questions? Thanks.
Okay. The delegation's registered.
Oh, Mr. Mayor, just before I leave, and maybe you can clarify this
for
me.
Sorry, your time has exceeded.
What a shame we never get to have a direct discourse with the CAO. Thank you.
No further delegations.
Go for it.
Thank you. Guys, I'm sorry. I got to ask you guys to respect the rules here at City Hall. So I'll just ask once again, please. We'll move to reports now. First report we had here is the religious or not-for-profit cemeteries frontage levy exemption.
As we see the delegations today, it seems that we found a good ground to move forward with this one, so I'll so move.
Okay. Councillor Gillingham?
Yeah, I just quickly want to speak on this and commend all those who worked on this, including the delegations we heard. They've been here several times. Our assessment taxation department, Mr. Chambers, and Councillor Eady and others that moved the motion and got behind this motion in the first place, and so I just want to commend all those involved.
Thank you. Okay, we'll call a question. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Thanks. Report 2 is Winnipeg Police Board proposed amendment to the Winnipeg Police Board Bylaw 148-2012.
I had pulled this matter down at a previous meeting. My thanks to city clerks and others for consulting. And we have a proposed amendment that I believe is before members here. Do I need then to just move the motion and then two separate votes or one vote?
No.
Okay. Just one. So the amendment for clarity is we amended clause A, clarified that the mayoral nominee could be a member of council or a member of the public. C was also going to be amended to expand the board by to two members, and therefore we have then amended now. What's different than what we saw, say, a month ago or a few weeks ago, B is amended so it could be a minimum of one and a maximum of two councillors. The statute indicates that no more than half of the members can be from council, and we are certainly underneath that because the board here would be between 7 and 9 because there are two provincial nominees as well. So the intent here is to simply sort of keep the council representation roughly where, as a percentage, where it was before. So under this model, there could be as few as one councillor, there could be as many as three, but it at least allows for a second councillor to be appointed not as chair or vice chair, but simply as a member of the board.
Councillor, and thanks for your efforts on this. I do want to take the opportunity just to thank our chair, David Asper, as well as all the members of the police board for their ongoing work, and of course our ongoing appreciation for the work of the members of the Winnipeg Police Service. Not hearing any other commentary, I'll call the question. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Thanks. Move to report 3, which is the Winnipeg Housing Steering Committee 2017 second and third quarter reports. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Thank you. We'll move to report 4, child abuse registry checks.
I'd like to ask Mr. Michael Jack if I'd like to ask him a few questions regarding this particular item. This is an item that came forward from the Lord Selkirk West Kildonan Community Committee and essentially asked two things, that all hiring and recruitment processes to acquire that a satisfactory criminal record, vulnerable persons, and child abuse registry checks be a requirement of employment by the City of Winnipeg for all employees that work with minors, and secondly, that to update all policies, administrative standards, and all other requirements to include that a satisfactory criminal record vulnerable persons and child abuse registry checks be a requirement for volunteer programs offered to minors through the City of Winnipeg or is conducted in or on City of Winnipeg-owned facilities. If Mr. Jack could just quickly define at a high level the definition of the criminal record, vulnerable persons, and child abuse registry checks.
Yeah, thank you, Councillor, and Mr. Mayor, thank you, Councillors. I'd like to give you a quick overview. This motion is timely for a couple of reasons that I will explain in a moment. Perhaps I'll start with what we already do have in place. For many years, and last updated in November of 2015, we've got a criminal record check protocol that's in place. It does define when these checks are going to be performed. And just to clarify at the outset, some of the terminology has been updated. So as opposed to criminal record check, as used in the motion, they're now referred to as police information checks. And as opposed to a separate vulnerable persons check, that is now referred to as a police information check with the vulnerable sector search. And there is still the availability through the province of a child abuse registry search. So essentially three different searches as contemplated by the motion, just slightly different terminology. It's a rather lengthy definition of vulnerable persons. That's likely the one that most people don't quite know exactly what is captured. So I'll just read it verbatim, at least from our policy. And that's defined as persons who, due to their age, disability, or other circumstances, are dependent on others or are at greater risk of harm than the general population from a person in a position of authority or trust. And so we already have, throughout the organization, as you would expect, we've got a regime of what searches are required. At a high level for today, the typical searches that are performed where all we require is a police information check, those are more the finance positions. Anyone in a position of trust that has anything to do with city finances. Obviously, as you might expect, both the child abuse registry and vulnerable sector searches, those are done with respect to exactly what this motion contemplates, where we have staff working with minors, obvious examples being in libraries, aquatics, but anyone that may be, even at the Animal Services Agency, because we have minors who come in and volunteer, many of the staff there are required to have those searches performed as well. So we do have a very lengthy list of the positions at the city that are already required. That will be very easy information to collect for you. In a related way, looking at number two, this will be a little broader, and we could use a little bit of time just to dig down, because it is, again, very good intention behind what is worded here. It casts a wide net, particularly when you look at the fact that it includes City of Winnipeg I'll back up a bit, volunteering programs offered to minors through the City of Winnipeg or is conducted in or on City of Winnipeg-owned facilities. As you know, we own all of the community center properties. And so, therefore, any activity that may be taking place at a community center would be captured by this motion. So that's where we'll need to go down and do a little more digging. Our own PeopleSoft system is being updated presently, and we will have that functionality to be able to very easily generate a list of the city employees to whom this applies. But, for instance, some group leasing space at a daycare, that's where we will need to do a little more digging. A lot of those, at a community center, I said daycare, mental slip, because that is typically the kind of organization that is renting space at a community center. And as you know, staff in a daycare are most typically, and I think universally, required to have things like child abuse registry checks performed in order to maintain their license. So we're happy to do some more digging here, depending on what is the will of the committee in terms of giving us some time to do so. I mentioned at the outset that the timing is particularly good because I'm advised by our Manager of Community Development and Recreation Services, Peter DeGraff, who I believe is up there in the gallery, that we are currently in the process of finalizing our management agreements, not only with the General Council of Winnipeg Community Centres, but the city is in fact finalizing management agreements with each and every of the 63 community centres. And what we are doing, and already were doing prior to this motion, is including very clear expectations regarding these searches. It is currently up to the community center themselves when they're going to require these searches and to what level, whereas we will now have the opportunity to work with them and specify and get a little more consistency and universality in when we're requiring these searches.
That's your question, Mr. Mayor. With regards to the child abuse registry, would the police information check already capture that information? If someone is on the child abuse registry, would that be on the police information check?
That's a detail I'm not sure, and I could easily get that information back from the police. I'm not sure whether it would be captured because I don't know. Certainly, the police information check will contain a record of convictions. I believe the child abuse registry check would likely go further, and I believe, depending on the nature of mere allegations, even if they didn't result in a criminal conviction, I think the child abuse registry would maintain a different level of information concerning that type of activity. But I will get a better definition for you on those as well.
And final question, Mr. Mayor, I saw Councillor Gillingham put up his hand, but I'm going to ask, basically the intention here is to look for 120 days, to give you 120 days to come back to us and to report on costs associated with this initiative, and if there's any partnerships perhaps with other agencies or NGOs that we could partner with and collaborate with.
Yeah, absolutely. We'll spell that out in our report back to you, and you've hit upon one of the key issues. I think it's a key issue for community centers, particularly with respect to volunteers. It is a constant issue of who should bear the cost. If it's a police information check, that administrative cost can be up to $45. And if someone is good enough to be volunteering their time for your community center, do you expect them to bear that cost? And if not, then that's a cost to the community center. And so you're right in identifying that cost is an issue. It can be a contentious issue, but we'll spell out those costs for you.
Thank you.
Councilor Gillingham.
Councilor, back again, ask my question. How much will this cost? Thank you.
Mayor, I'd like to move that we provide 120 days for the administration to come back relative to partnerships and the costs associated with doing this initiative.
Thank you, Councillor. I'll just weigh in with my comments as well. I mean, I want to thank Councillor Eady for bringing this matter forward in the Community Committee, also for the work the Public Service is already doing to protect children in our facilities. One of the things I'm very proud of is our partnership with the Canadian Centre for Child Protection. We've led the nation in working with the Canadian Centre for Child Protection. For those that are watching these proceedings, if you don't know much about this national-based organization, they're doing international leading work. And we launched a partnership whereby they're assisting with the training of our staff, notably our swimming pools, with a public communication that our corporate communications team has been in leading. And, you know, in terms of our responsibilities, you know, it's something that I'm very proud of this council and our public service for the work that they've done to date. I think this is obviously additional work that can occur, and I'm hoping there can be some dialogue with the Canadian Centre for Child Protection and other groups I know nationally that are doing some really good work, and there's an opportunity to see where we can do even better to protect kids in our facilities. So I want to thank everybody involved, notably the public service and members of council who've been working on this. Not hearing any other comments, we'll vote on the motion as proposed. Councillor Pagetan has moved it. All in favour?
Aye.
Carried. Thank you.
Thanks,
Mike. Okay, we'll move to Report 5, which is Provincial Agreement for Enhanced Recreation Programs for Children and Youth in Winnipeg's Inner City.
I'm very happy to move this. Some really good programs happening throughout the city by groups as Art City, Graffiti Art Programming, the North End Community Renewal Corporation, the University of Manitoba Faculty of Kinesiology, University of Manitoba Wise Kinetic Energy, and the William White Neighborhood Association. Just a key point as well that this motion looks to provide a delegated authority to our CFO in the future relative to this particular program, so just to help streamline things. So I'd like to move concurrence.
Okay, we'll call a question. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Thanks. Report 6, discounts to be allowed for prepayment of 2018 realty, personal property, and business taxes.
I'll move report number 6.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Carried. Thanks. I believe.
Move suspension of rules for addendum reports.
Great. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Thanks. Addendum report is Winnipeg Arts Council 2018-20 corporate plan and budget.
Yes, Mr. Mayor, I'd be happy to move this and thank the Winnipeg Arts Council for the work that they do across the city and with all the various art agencies that they work with within the city of Winnipeg. So I'd like to move this as information.
Okay. Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Thanks. We'll move to committee reports. First committee report is Standing Policy Committee on Infrastructure Renewal and Public Works, dated October 31st, 2017. Councillor. Sorry. You want to
stand down number two?
Sure.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I think the clerk is going to be passing out some packages to the committee members and the CAO. I would like to move items one. I see three is stood down, so I'll move items one, two.
Two.
Sorry, two is stood down?
Two is stood down, yeah.
So one, thank three, you. And four, and I will stand down item five. So I'll move item.
Sorry, four. Just for clarity, which ones are you moving? Why don't we just do them separately, just for clarity?
Sure, okay.
Yeah, so why don't we go for
I'll move item number one. It's the Winnipeg amendments to the Winnipeg parking bylaw that would allow for them to conduct different pilot projects around parking in the city.
Okay. Not hearing a commentary. We'll call the question. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Thank you. Report two is. I'll let you read them out.
I'll remove report two, innovation on street parking. Same thing, looking for innovative solutions for parking in the Exchange District.
Okay. Councillor Pagnacan.
I just stood this item down simply to put a few good words on the record, and that I really want to thank the work of the Winnipeg Parking Authority and the folks from Planning Property and Development here. This original motion that came out from myself and seconded by Councillor Lutz was basically to look for innovative parking solutions within the Exchange District. The Exchange District is seeing a lot of development, both residential, business, mixed-use development, and it's, you know, there is only one Exchange District in our city of Winnipeg within the downtown. It's a great area, a very vibrant area, and but it's got a problem of parking. So we're looking at creating more parking solutions, and really pleased to see that there was a pilot project that examined angled parking on Bannatyne. And I was there along with Councillor Morantz and several members of the public service and various business owners this past summer to launch that pilot project, which is going very well, and it's receiving a lot of accolades in terms of its ability to accommodate 11 additional parking spots. So I really want to thank the Parking Authority and our Public Works staff for that. Also, the Parking Authority is looking at applying some technical guidelines with regards to loading zones within the Exchange District, and with that, they're going to be working with area businesses to provide, it looks like, up to possibly 52 additional on-street parking spots, which is really good news. You know, this ability to look at innovative strategies for loading zones and angle parking, just really want to lend my compliments to the department for that.
So thanks very much for your work on this, as well as for our committee chair and, of course, members of the committee. You know, I know the East Exchange Residents Association mm-hmm. have been very vocal about the success of downtown, the fact that we've got roughly 2,000 more residents than were living in downtown when this new council was elected. And with that means the issue of parking is becoming more acute and the need for additional spaces and turnover. So it's I really want to commend you for your work. I know you've been a very strong voice for this issue and for the residents in the East Exchange. Not hearing any other comments, call a question then. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Thanks. We'll move to report the Councillor. I'll let you read them out.
I'll move report number three, ICE and control policy. This report is not to be confused with the actual report that's coming back from the acting director regarding our snow policy. This was actually something that was moved by my colleague, Councillor Orlico, to identify different schools where we needed to provide some additional service around snow clearing. The motion is to, I believe, provide snow clearing services to 18 additional schools in the drop-off zones. And there's an additional cost, which is to be approved from the snow and ice control budget of $31,000. So I will move I'll move this report.
Councillor Olico.
Thank you very much. This issue was brought up by, Rebuff School. They are about a block away from J.B. Mitchell School. So every winter, J.B. Mitchell gets plowed, and then eventually they get to robot school, but, you know, that's, it's pretty harsh for those people. So the pastor at the place, he brought up the issue of, like, why not us? And so, and then we learned it was about bus access. But really what we're trying to do is we're trying to make a safe drop-off for all people. So the bus argument needed to expand, and we needed to find ways that we can make sure that all schools, private and public, with bus service or no bus service, we quickly get the snow cleared. So when those parents come to drop off or the bus comes to drop them off, it can be done in as safe of an environment as possible. So I thank Public Works for this recommendation. I think it'll go a long way to assisting schools throughout Winnipeg. We are Winnipeg. We do get those snowfalls to make sure that the drops off are safer for all.
Thanks for your work on this. I also want to just acknowledge the work of our council liaison regarding schools has been vocal on these and many other issues on just how we can leverage the tools we have to work more collaboratively with schools and school boards. And they've been incredibly responsive. I know through Councillor Mays, as well as direct correspondence with myself and other members of council, including yourself, Councillor Olico, that dialogue is really helpful. And so obviously I'll be supporting this as well. Call the question then. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Carried. Thanks.
Okay, Mr. Mayor, our next item is subject to some controversy. It's item number 5.
Nope, we got 4.
Oh, 4. I'm sorry. Yeah.
I'm really
very anxious to get to number 5.
Yeah, I know, as is everyone else. I'm
sure. But that does not mean that gravel roads are not important. So, yeah. Number 4, cost-sharing option for residents living on gravel roads. I'd like to move this report.
This report is seeking 30-day extension?
Yes.
Okay, just wanted to
thank you for the clarification.
Yeah. Okay. So all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Carried.
Okay. Yep. Item 5 then, Mr. Mayor. Firstly, I want to thank all the delegations today for their presentations. They were, I think, some of the highest quality presentations I've ever seen since I've been here on council, and I think that they made all the points that really had to be made. I've said this over and over, Mr. Mayor, I am 100% in support of the residents of my ward. The residents are livid, and so am I. This Rogue 4 option was just a ridiculous idea from the beginning. Not one elected official saw it or approved it. It appears that there may have been efforts to actually circumvent the will of council. And I'm going to get into that later in the package I passed around and show you why I think that that is a possibility. I'm calling on all of council to join me in killing this ill-thought-out plan that would have destroyed a neighborhood. Something so ridiculous is not going to happen in my ward on my watch. Now, interesting, Mr. Steek said that that he and the residents of my ward can handle the truth. So am I, and I say this in some jest, but as an X-Files fan, I know the truth is out there. And I'm going to make it my mission to find out what happened. And I really hope that all of you and all of council come along with me on that journey. Just to give a bit of history, after we approved the report in 2015 to fund the engineer, public engagements commenced, and in 2016 there were a number of meetings where the three options were presented. Sometime in September, I was advised by Mr. Berzowski that there was a mistake made that came out in the IRPW hearings, that the environmental application was made prematurely. I didn't fully understand what that meant at the time, not having ever been involved in an environmental application, that actually an alignment was submitted. That came to light shortly after, and as a result of that, the Public Works Department called a special meeting of the community. You'll see the letter in my package basically saying, we want to talk to you about the expropriation process, without advising me or any elected official. I think it goes without saying that is maddening, to say the least. So anyway, as a result of this, the community activated and formed the South Wilkes Community Association. And I've been working very closely with them and their consultant, Ms. Havixbeck. We had a meeting with them. Mr. McNeil, CEO, was kind enough to come to that meeting. And I had a frank discussion with them. And out of that came the idea that we would create a motion that would clarify that the east-west alignment was to be on Wilkes. That is the motion that is in front of us today. What I want to just go through, Mr. Mayor, is well, before I do that, I also want to say a couple of other things. The Class 3 estimate, and I'll get into that, that was provided on this, what I call Rogue Option 4, is very concerning. Because my question really is, and maybe I'll get to this with Mr. McNeil, how is it that an alignment that no one ever saw or knew about was cost-engineered down to a Class 3 estimate and that it got so far to make an environmental application when the other three options were the only options that were shown to the public? The only real conclusion you could draw from that is that the public consultations were essentially a sham, that they were meaningless, and whoever was running this project decided long ago that this route 4 was going to be where the road went. That's simply not acceptable. Also, I want to mention that with respect to Fort White, Mr. Elliott unfortunately couldn't be here today. He's the director, but he did write an email in support of the motion, and essentially, this roadway would be carving up a piece of Fort White's 640 acres of protected green space, award-winning ecological destination in our city, visited by tens of thousands of people annually without consultation. There are all kinds of issues that arise from that, one of which just comes to mind is noise and exhaust disturbing wildlife and habitat. I can't even imagine that the province would accept granting an environmental license application. I'm sure that they would give pause if they, when they looked at this and said, well, why is this road going through Fort White? And Fort White is certainly not supporting it. I am fiscally responsible. I think everybody knows that. I spent 2 years as chair of finance. I know a lot has been made about the issues of cost analysis here, and I am 100% behind that. But at the same time, we have an obligation to protect the citizens of our ward who have had a cloud cast over the title of their homes. They don't know what their homes are worth. I ask members of this committee, would you buy a house on Loudoun under these circumstances? We're still issuing building permits on these streets, and yet we're putting out plans that no one ever saw before that we're going to run a road through these properties. It's absurd. It's absolutely absurd. I can't even believe we're having this conversation. It must be a dream. It can't be real, Mr. Mayor. Just, I want to turn to my package that I passed out to all of you. And I'm actually going to start on the last page and move forward. The last page is the executive summary of the environmental license application that was submitted to the province in July of 2017, so just a few months ago. In the second paragraph, it says, this Environment Act proposal report is being submitted in support of an Environment Act license for phase one of the proposed project, which will involve connecting the existing William R. Clement Parkway at Grand Avenue south approximately 2.2 kilometers to a, and these are the key words, Mr. Mayor, to a new east-west alignment of Sterling Line Parkway south of Wilkes Avenue, written, Mr. Mayor, in July of 2017, before the conclusion of public consultations, an alignment that no one ever saw before. The next page is the letter dated July 27, 2017, from the engineering firm to the province. In the first paragraph, this is to the Environmental Approvals Branch, Manitoba Sustainable Development, regarding the Environment Act proposal for the William R. Clement Parkway extensions. in the middle of the first paragraph. The proposed project will involve the extension of the current William R. Clement Parkway south to a new realigned Sterling Line Parkway. That's July 27, 2017. It gets worse, Mr. Mayor. The next page, a memorandum from the engineer to the city. This memorandum is dated May 27th, 2016, over a year before the environmental license application was actually submitted. And in it, it says, in the second paragraph, Phase 1 involves connecting the existing WRCP at Grant Avenue south approximately 2.2 kilometers to a new east-west alignment south of the existing Wilkes Avenue. In May of 2016. Next page. Next page is a map from the environmental application. And it shows a road running through homes on McCreary Road. This map, Mr. Mayor, is a map of the Rogue 4 alignment. It's date stamped May of 2016 and has the engineer and the city stamp on it. It's May of 2016. Next page. Part of the same maps. This one is a map of Rogue 4 running through Liberty and Loudoun. This is date stamped May of 2016. Next page is the last page of the submission that was made. Summary of public engagement, phase two, for the William R. Clement Parkway and Sterling Line Parkway extensions. Functional preliminary design study. It's got the engineers, it's prepared by the engineers and for the City of Winnipeg. It's dated September 2016 and it's online. In the conclusion, it says, and I'm sorry I don't have this highlighted, but it's the last line of clause 3.0. Based on how 379 individuals rank the design options, the following are the respondents' preferences for the WRCP extension. The very first point, option one, east-west Wilkes Avenue alignment. That was the conclusion in the public consultation report. Next page, page 7 of the same report. It says, just bear with me, it basically says that Wilkes Avenue was the preference that came out of the options. Finally, Mr. Mayor, at the very front of the package is a letter that was sent by Public Works out to the community. This letter was sent as a reaction to the mistake. And I've asked the acting director about this. This letter was sent out to the community as a result of the mistake made, which was the premature submission of the environmental license application. Because when it became known, when the Rogue 4 option became public, the department made the choice to go out and say this was the option that they were going to be recommending. Again, before anyone on council saw this, before I saw it, before anyone in the world actually saw it, except we know, you know, and I want to thank Mr. Ferguson for being here. Mr. Ferguson knew about it because he was hired by apparently by the engineering firm in 2015 for the sole purpose of planning this Rogue option. How baffling that is, it's amazing. But I want to read the last two paragraphs of this letter. And I want to ask you when you're listening to me read these words, imagine if you were receiving a letter like this, or you were a city councillor or the mayor, and the people you represent received a letter like this without you knowing about it. I have to say for the record that this letter was sent to me, but after it was submitted to the public and not before. The City of Winnipeg would like the opportunity to meet with you because part or all of your property may be required for the William R. Clement Parkway and Sterling Line Parkway extensions. It is important to note that at this time no funding has been allocated for the construction of this project, nor has a construction timeline been set. We would like to meet with all landowners whose properties may be impacted by the new roadways at a special meeting to describe the project, the land acquisition process in more detail, and answer any questions you may have. I don't really have anything else to say about this letter other than I'm actually speechless. I think we can all draw our own conclusions from it, but I really have nothing else to say about it. I think it really makes its own point. Now, Mr. McNeil, I do have a few questions for you. A lot of this ground we covered at the IRPW meeting. I don't want to go over too much more of it, but I do need to ask a couple of questions, just for the record. And so my first question is, did you instruct the engineer to pursue Rogue Option 4?
No.
Do you know who in the public service instructed the engineer to pursue Rogue Option 4?
Not yet.
Are you trying to find out who did that?
Yes.
Okay. Will you report back to us on the results of that investigation?
I will, but it may be in confidence if it's a human resources matter.
Fair enough. Thank you. With respect to Ms. Havoc-Beck raised a point about area plans and precinct plans, and I don't share property, and so it's like the concepts are, I always get a little bit confused with the concepts, but I think basically the concept is that what the city normally does is plan for an area, and once that plan is in place, the roads are part of that plan, that we don't plan a road and then do an area plan. Could you comment on that, on why we didn't have a broader plan for this area before you came forward with us?
I don't know why we don't have that broader plan. The director of planning is here. He might be able to speak to that if you wish.
What do you think?
You know what, why don't I just suggest, Councillor, that you finish your introductory remarks.
Sure.
I wouldn't mind providing Doug an opportunity to just provide commentary as
well. Course, yeah.
And then maybe based on that commentary, we can decide whether or not we want the director to maybe offer some additional comments and respond to questions that you or other members of council may have.
That sounds fine, Mr. Mayor. Thank you.
Just
a couple more things.
Okay. Yeah.
Ms. Havoc-Beck raised this point about the environmental assessment focusing north of Wilkes and not south of Wilkes. Do you know what that's about? Or
I scanned the environmental assessment and it included both areas.
Okay. So maybe that's something we just need to clarify.
Mm-hmm.
At the end of the day, I think that really we need to get to the bottom of how this happened, Mr. McNeil, respectfully. We need to protect the citizens from this kind of thing ever happening again. And so, look, I look forward to hearing your perspective on this, and I'm going to relinquish the floor to you, and you can offer your commentary.
So we'll... Maybe if you want to take an opportunity now, maybe just to walk through. I know we heard a lot of commentary. Thank you very much, Councillor. And I know we heard a lot of commentary today on this from a number of delegates. There were some new information and assertions that were made that I think we all took note of. And I don't know if you can, whatever commentary you could provide on this matter, I think it would be helpful as well. Because I know you have also been spending a lot of time on this matter in the last few weeks.
Inordinate.
Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, EPC. I guess what I'd like to say is that I support the motion because we need to move forward on this project. The William R. Clement Parkway extension is an important piece in the Inner Ring Road. It was in the Transportation Master Plan from some years ago. It was expected that it would extend south from Grant Avenue in a southerly direction, cross McGilvery, turn east, and then connect into Keniston Boulevard, Bishop Grandin extension. That's well known. The same Transportation Master Plan identified Wilkes as that connector to the William Clement Parkway extension, and nothing else. We hired MMM to look at, again, Clement Parkway together with the Wilkes East-West connector And so there was a lot of work done. They had the public meeting. They had produced in concept three. Now I'll focus mostly on the east-west connector. They had the three options, one, two, and three. They showed it to the public. Councillor Morantz referred to the public ranking of the options. Wilkes was first, just south of Wilkes was second, and far south of Wilkes was third. That was in based on a public meeting in January. But those results weren't shown until September 16. Both of those documents, both the poster boards from the January 16 public meeting and the results of the public consultation, which is from September 16, both of those are on their website. What's disturbing and is news to me, and thank you, Councillor Morantz, is that there's evidence here that the public service was working on what they call a variation of option two. We're calling it now option four now, as early as, evidenced by drawings, shortly after the public meeting. And it's disturbing because the public had indicated that that wasn't their preference. It's also, it wasn't option two, even though option two, and I've since learned, technically option two was determined by the engineers and the other public service participants from various departments to be technically better than option one. But I don't understand how we all of a sudden went to option four and didn't share it with the public. That was the huge mistake. And so had we done that, and I mentioned this at IRPW, we would have had the same reaction we're having right now, but would have been back sometime in 2016. That would have told the public service, wait a minute, this could be an error, and so let's reset. And what are we going to recommend to council? That's the other error. Nothing went to council after that conceptual stage to say, here's what we came up with, here's what the public supports or doesn't support. We need council's direction to do a functional design on the preferred route. None of that happened. The public service went out, did the functional design on option four, as the councillor said. Nobody in senior administration or council, the ward councillor, chair of public works had seen before, and did all that work. And then as part of that process, applied for environmental license. So the reason I say that I support the motion is that had we done what we should have done over a year ago, we would have been proceeding with looking at options for 20 of Wilkes Avenue. And so, and to the point where people are developing, subdividing, whatever, and we're issuing building permits, and we don't know where this road's going. That's why we need to complete this project. We need to know where the road is going, and so that people know with certainty when they buy a lot or they plan to subdivide or they're going to build a new house, that they're not going to be affected into the future. And that's what's really important about the transportation planning for the city and understanding where those roads go. So I would like to finish this project for that purpose, so that we can properly plan going forward, we can issue the permits or subdivision approvals or whatever the case may be. Now, talking about Wilkes Avenue, there's been lots of different numbers thrown around, and I can appreciate the work that Mr. Ferguson has done. The one thing I will note is that in looking just at Wilkes and not looking at Clement, you got to connect the two. And how do you connect those two? And so there's been, the original option one actually shows Wilkes east of Clement going south through a little bit of Loudoun and a little bit of Liberty and connecting south of Wilkes Avenue, because there's a bridge over the tracks and you got to bring that bridge down to grade, and that's where Wilkes would connect. So that was the original number one. And that's the numbers that I have from WSP and I issued to council on Monday. They are different than the numbers that Mr. Ferguson indicated for in terms of land acquisition, because he picked purely a route along Wilkes and no dipping down, if I might add. So, I mean, that's the problem. We're throwing out all kinds of different options, and we haven't studied any of them. We haven't done any detailed cost estimates on the engineering or on the land acquisition.
Other than one that we never knew about.
Correct. I'm talking, Councillor, I'm focusing on Wilkes now. We have not, aside from a relative comparison of options 1, 2, and 3 for costs, you know, there has been not a lot of work done on the Wilkes option. And that's where we need to go with this, so that we can take the, those options to the public for twinning of Wilkes. And people are aware there are points that we may need to dip down, like possibly around the hydro substation, possibly around the gas valve, I'll call it station, further west, and possibly down to connect to Sterling, to William Clement Parkway. We don't know, but we'd like to, what we did for option 4, we'd like to do for Wilkes, and that's why I'm supporting this motion, so that we can provide that certainty and come up with options, share them with the public, and then with the results from the public, bring it back to council and provide certainty to what's happening with Wilkes Avenue. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there a desire to have the director come down as well?
Planning?
What do you think? I can answer it.
Sure. Yeah. Oh,
okay.
Thank you, Doug. Let's open up to councillors, please. Councillor Olivo?
I think Councillor Olivo. He can answer the question.
I do recall when this issue was brought up quite a few years ago on the planning side, exactly the points we made today. I didn't even want to talk about this, Wilkes or any type of route, because until we have an area plan on what we plan to do for the area, how do you put a road in? Where do you put the roads in? Collector streets, all those streets. What type of neighborhood are we going to be developing? So I was very unhappy when I saw this, because I thought the matter was resolved, that we're not discussing going into south, either between McGilvery and Wilkes, because we need to do an area plan first. It's a huge project to do an area plan for that area. Again, council hasn't provided direction. It's quite simple. Council, even though it doesn't feel it today, is supreme. We would direct our administration to do so and get some feedback from them. But right now, we get those lists every year of where the planning priorities are for the city. Right now, we are going through the Our Winnipeg review. So we have said new precincts and pretty well this idea. Is this where we see Winnipeg growing? My gut feeling is yes. I see that happening. But through the Art of Winnipeg review, we're going to determine what areas, with our resources we have available, we're going to focus on planning. Planning is huge in the city of Winnipeg. I think there's local neighborhoods, new neighborhoods. This would be a greenfield area. We'd have to examine the water tables. We have to examine a lot of things. So again, I didn't believe we were ready to go to do this yet until the Art of Winnipeg review. That said, we're going to have to seriously consider it now, because the neighborhood has been very disrupted by this idea of slapping a road through them without any context of how that would fit into their neighborhood and what is the future. And I think we've heard today, that is one of the underlying currents I've heard today, is what is the future here? What is going to go on in our neighborhood? So again, I'm not committing that we will do a big area plan at this point. I have to meet with them. But again, that really, before we decide to put regional roads through different areas, it has to be developed in the context of what the whole neighborhood will be. So I was a little dismayed to even see this coming forward like this. I thought we were quite clear when we had that meeting that that's not something that we want to even look at this point, because of the issues of the neighborhood have about where would the roads go, collectors, regionals, high density, low densities, commercial zones, green spaces, connectivity to the parks, all that. So again, this to me is very problematic that Public Works has decided to go off this way and do this. Again, it shows some issues in our planning. We've had issues again with water sometimes as well. And I know that the department, they need to be done together. The left hand and the right hand have to be working together. And this is an example where I see the left hand did what it did. Without really consulting with the department.
Thank you. Mr. Mayor, we've heard from residents today, and we've heard from their representatives. We've heard from our CAO. We've just heard from our chair of planning, property, and development, and I certainly appreciate all of them. Certainly those that have come today taking their time out of their lives, their work lives, and other daily schedules to be here and to present today. And they presented us with a lot of information. And I certainly appreciate the work that my colleague, Councillor Morantz, has done on this matter. He has been an advocate, a defender, a supporter of his residents, as he should be. He's worked very hard on their behalf. He certainly now knows this file inside and out, even more so than those of us that are working hard to catch up. The process has been a mess. That's probably an understatement. I think we all agree on that. The residents, Councillor Morantz, EPC, the rest of council should not have been put in this position, that's clear. However, there's still important information that I believe we don't have, or at least there's a lack of clarity around some of the information. And I think that's been spelled out here again today. And it's the information I think that we need to make this decision. For example, there is lack of clarity around the cost, for example, of the Wilkes route, anywhere from, I think, the low end of 30 to up to 160 million. What is the number? You know, I've been told we're not even confident in a class five, or what has been recorded, you know, stated to us as a class five. The decisions that we make on this matter, as we all know, they're not temporary decisions. The decisions that we're going to make will have immediate implications, and it'll have implications for generations to come as to where a road ultimately goes in and through this part of the city of Winnipeg. So I believe that it's important to have an opportunity to review the new information, some of its new information we received today, have an opportunity to kind of get to collect information and get some questions answered on some outstanding questions. And so with respect to the residents and with respect to Council Morantz, Mr. Mayor, I move that this matter be laid over.
If the suggestion is to lay over this motion, I am 100% opposed to
it. Sure. Why don't we let Councillor Gillingham finish, and then we'll open it up to commentary after he's finished speaking. So let's just let the Councillor finish, and then we can open it up for discussion. Okay. Thanks, Councillor.
So, yes, simply, I move to not to extend this, you know, unduly for the residents, but this is a long-term decision that we're trying to make when there's a lack of, a lack of clarity around the information. So I move the matter be laid over until the next Executive Policy Committee meeting so that we have opportunity to review the information we've been given today, which is some new information, and have opportunity also to get updates and information from the public service before we make our decision. That's my motion.
Thank you, Councillor. Councillor Mays, and then we'll jump back to Councillor Morantz. And then Councillor Packbecan.
I am struck by the irony of number four, as people in rural areas have raised repeatedly the desire to get their gravel roads paved, and here we have at number five a massive paved road project that's been completely ill thought through and is being rammed through. And the amount of work, it's just the irony of this is inescapable to me, at least. I'm inclined to say how much work Councillor Morantz has put into this, and we certainly heard from the residents. We certainly heard repeatedly from Councillor Morantz. I am inclined to agree to the layover in that I certainly don't support option four. I can see how that's a non-starter, but it really isn't clear to me where to go on option one, two, or three. I don't know that we even need to decide that. I mean, I'm sure I will now get emails from my ward saying, well, suddenly this twinning of Wilkes is going to pole vault over all these other projects. What about the twinning of St. Anne's? All of these sorts of issues will start surfacing. So we need to be clear on what it is we're doing, the priority of it, where we're going. I don't favor the option, that the rogue option, as some people have termed it, that kind of got dropped into the middle of this area, and people rightly have been very upset by that and by this letter that Councillor Morantz is just quoted from. It sort of speaks for itself that you get a letter saying we may need some or all of your land for this thing we've never told you about. It's just unbelievable. But for the reasons Councillor Orlicore articulated, that we need to have a better idea of what, if this is meant to serve an area, we better figure out what that area is going to look like before we build the road.
So I would support the layover, but I do want to make it clear. I don't support this option four. That's not a starter, and Councilor Morantz has made that case, I think, very clearly.
Councilor Morantz, and then Councilor Pat again.
Mr. Mayor, I must implore members of EPC to vote on this motion today. The people of this community of Charleswood need our support. They need certainty. There has been a cloud cast over the values of their homes, and they're looking to us to protect them. Just because we passed the motion saying it's going to be looked doesn't mean we're not going to get cost engineering on a Wilkes route. And ultimately, council is supreme, so council will have to decide at the end of the day whether it will approve something like that or not. At the end, what this will do simply is give the residents of Charleswood some peace of mind that we're not going to run a road through their homes. So I'm completely opposed to the idea of a layover. I certainly won't be supporting it. I want to also say, and with respect to Councillor May's remarks, at the very least, we should be saying right here and now that rogue option four is completely off the table.
Okay. Thank you, Councillor. Councillor Packney.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mayor. I really appreciate the delegations coming here today. I really thank Councillor Morantz for standing up to this and representing his citizens. And with respect to Councillor Gillingham's motion, I think I'm leaning towards supporting Councillor Morantz today, only because I'm looking at the website of the City of Winnipeg here. I'm looking at the documents, the storyboards, the open house invitation. I'm looking at the 111-page preliminary design. I don't see anything with regards to the fourth option on here, and that is pretty disheartening. And Councillor Morantz's motion here talks about something that I've been working on this file with major project management and investment planning. His final be it resolved is that the Wilkes Avenue alignment to the William R. Clement Parkway Extension project be reevaluated through the infrastructure planning office processes. I think that's great news, and thank you very much, Councillor Morantz, for putting that information in there, because that's really what we're trying to do here at City Hall, is to ensure that projects that move forward in the planning stages, that we go through the best practices that municipalities can go through with respect to doing major capital projects and investment planning. And this is a huge project as part of the inner ring roadway, Ms. Mayor, and this is it can't be taken lightly. The fact that the residents all the while were shown three options and then a fourth option coming out of nowhere really is inexcusable, and I applaud Councillor Morantz for that. And I really feel for the residents. When Councillor Morantz wrote this letter, putting myself in the shoes of seeing the presentation here and hearing for the first time that their home could be expropriated to the city for a possible project that they weren't even aware of as part of the public open houses is very disturbing. So, Councillor Morantz, you're showing leadership on this. This is our job to show leadership. You're showing leadership here, so I'll support you with this, with your particular motion saying that the Wilkes Avenue alignment is a preferred alignment.
Thank you, Councillor Packington.
Yeah. Councillor Gilroy.
I support Councillor Gillingham in laying this motion over, and I do feel for the community members and Councillor Morantz, but I just think that there's a lot of new information that was provided here today. I don't think it hurts for us to make sure that we have all the tools needed to make this decision. This is a tough decision. I just think that with all the information that was given today, I have a lot more questions for administration and would like that extra time. So. I do understand what you're going through, Councillor Morantz, and the people that are living with this decision, but I do support Councillor Gillingham in laying this over.
So I'll just offer my comments as well. Firstly, I want to thank all the delegations for coming down. This has been an exhaustive effort and a stressful effort for each of the property owners that are affected. And I want to say unequivocally to those residents who have come here that are watching, that are directly impacted by this matter, that we hear you. And I hope that's something that that all are hearing, regardless of the position on a layover, albeit a short layover, that message has been provided loud and clear. And you're not going to find a stronger voice for the residents of the ward than Councillor Morantz. He has been very vocal with members of council and with the public service. He has been unwavering in his support for the residents. And he has certainly impressed upon me, and I know all of us around this table and with other councillors, the stress and the effects that this is having on his residents. And so I don't think, his support for the residents should be questioned. On the contrary, he's been a very strong and a very vocal and effective voice for the residents. And so I want to thank Councillor Morantz for your work on this matter. I also want to acknowledge the work of our CAO, who over the last few weeks has been putting in a lot of time to get to the bottom of this, has apologized, and whom we need to continue digging and providing those of us around this table and members of council with additional information, and also taking steps to ensure that it doesn't happen again. And I'm certainly going to work with him, and I know, and I ask all members of council to do the same, because we all have a vested interest in making sure that the process improves going forward, and so and that the accountability is being provided right now. I've provided commentary to many of you, and also through the media, that we're reacting. We're having to respond to a situation that none of us could have predicted a few weeks ago, at least, that this would be an issue we'd be having to deal with. What I want to do, obviously, is ensure that the residents hear loud and clear today, that we've listened. The materials that have been provided today, I'm going to review them in great detail. All but I think the last delegate provided some substantive information for our consideration and some written material that we can actually review and consider. And I want to have an opportunity to do that. I'll be supporting the layover. I know it's just till the next executive policy meeting, during which time we can hopefully take a chance to review these materials. We can continue, and all members of council can continue to ask questions of our public service. And I'll certainly be working diligently with Councillor Morantz, and I know all members of EPC, to try to provide some answers to the residents and to all citizens of the city on this matter as soon as we can, in a thoughtful way, being as informed as we can. And we got a lot of good information here that we can consider. I'm confident we can find a path forward that responds to, unfortunately, the reality that we've been placed in, but also is a thoughtful path forward. And so I want to thank all members of council for their efforts on this and thoughts today. Councillor Morantz, did you want to?
Thank you for that, Mr. Mayor, and I do hope that does provide some reassurance to the neighbours. I still maintain that I made my points already. This motion is extremely important. I do not support the idea of a layover. I do say that respectfully. I know this has been a very difficult issue for all of us, and the residents here today are seeing this play out in real time, in public, and I think that's a very healthy process. I am vehemently opposed to the idea of a layover, and I'm on the record as saying that. And so I will not be supporting it. If that is the will of this committee, then so be it. We'll deal with it 2 weeks from now. I believe when is it laid over to?
Sorry?
Next meeting is November 29th.
Two weeks?
Yeah. 2 weeks. So it'll be November 29th.
And when is the next council meeting after that?
Council would be on December 13th.
So it'd be November 28th?
November 29th would be the next EPC. And then the council meeting is on December 13th.
Okay, so we still have an opportunity to deal with the motion before the end of the year.
Yeah.
All right, well, as I said, I really want to deal with today, but respectfully, I will not be supporting the motion for the layover.
Thank you. Any further comments? Okay, so we'll call a question on the layover. All in favor?
Aye.
Actually, we should do recorded.
Yeah.
Did I beat you to the punch?
I'd like it to be a recorded vote.
Yeah, so let's record it then. All in favor?
Aye.
So we got,
Mr. Clerk, I want very clearly noted in the hansards of this meeting that I am completely opposed to the idea of laying this motion over.
I just want to record the votes properly, Councillor. We've got five.
Councillor Gilroy, Councillor Mays, Your Worship.
Yeah.
Councillors Lorillico and Councillors Gillingham are recorded in support of the motion.
And opposed.
Councillors Pactigan and Councillors Morantz are recorded in opposition to the motion.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, everybody, on this one. And thank you to the residents who came down here today. We'll move on to the next matter, which is the Standing Policy Committee on Protection, Community Services, and Parks.
Yes. I'd like to move items one, and just want to speak really briefly to item number two.
Okay. So we'll call the question on one. Do you want to, if I could ask Councillor for you to read what it relates to, item one, just before we vote on it, for those
Item one is the Literacy for Life Fund, Mr. Mayor.
Okay, so we'll call the question. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Report two.
Yes, so item number two is a motion that came from council as automatic referral. We dealt with it at committee, basically asking the public service to come back in 120 days to look at part five of the neighborhood livability bylaw with regards to outdoor patio music, Mr. Mayor, emanating from outdoor patios between the hours of 11 o'clock and 8 a.m. So there was a lot of support from residences here all over the downtown and in the Exchange District. This motion is looking at the view of a citywide view. For those folks who were, there was some misinformation in terms of special events, so things like the Jazz Festival or the Meme Festival. As applications come in for special events that go into the night, Mr. Mayor, those are still going to be heard and likely very much supported as time goes on. And those festivals will often go past midnight, sometimes till 12:30, 1 o'clock in the night on a weekend. And so those are taken into consideration on a one-off basis. But this is basically to provide clarity for establishments who have outdoor patios. So basically from Sunday to Thursday that we're proposing an 11 o'clock time for music to end, and basically Fridays and Saturdays at the time being 12 o'clock. So this is just providing that kind of clarity, and like I say, we're going to come back in 120 days for the public service, and we'll discuss these items at committee.
Okay, thank you, Councillor. We'll call a question then. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Next report is Standing Policy Committee on Property and Development, Heritage, and Downtown Development.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I move items 1 through 9.
Okay, we'll pull 8 and 9, so we'll vote on 1 through 7 inclusive. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Report 8. Councillor Mays.
Certainly in favor of the lease. That this will mean that all of our sites that got turf fields due to FIFA, all of them are wrapped up, except for the one in St. Vital, where we're still trying to hammer out the lease. The key is the line that's in this report. As field turf has a lifespan of roughly 10 years, the tenant was seeking to ensure that the investment of the improvement could be fully realized. Let us remember that when we continue on discussions. We are still trying to work out with the Bonnie Vital Soccer Club. I want to actually thank the CAO, who's had a bit of a hard day. I want to thank the CAO for his work trying to resolve this. He had a meeting with me and the then head of Public Works, I think, then our Parks head, Mr. Domke, and actually was the then head of Community Services, Mr. Whiteman. Almost a year ago, we are still not resolved. I will be raising this matter again and trying to nail down the lease. Glad to see we've got it done for Ralph Cantafano here. That leaves only the Bonnie Vital site, which is by a school, as the mayor has pointed out, Glenlawn Collegiate, where they run their soccer academy on our turf field at Memorial Park. So I will return to this theme in due course, but for today I just wanted to make the point that these things have a lifespan. You got to get a lease agreement to get these things protected, these million-dollar turf fields.
Thank you, Councillor. We'll call the question. Do you want to comment?
Yeah, I'll just comment. I definitely see where he's going on his. This is an extension of the lease agreement that's very appreciated by the Linden Lindenwood's neighborhood. There's a new call center that's opened up in the old Stantex building that is causing an enormous amount of parking issues in the neighborhood. And this is a great use of a site that is not being utilized in the daytime, inevitably for parking. It will generate a little bit of revenue. So we're quite, I think it's one of those classic win-wins. So I'm very supportive of it.
Great. Okay. Thank you. We'll call a question. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Last report is number 9, lease agreement.
Praise. We've had some criticism of civil service. I've done that myself in the past a time or two. But I wanted to praise Sarah Cianflone from our planning area for very hard and diligent work to pull this together with the lease agreement. This is the Portage and Main area of St. Vital, the St. Mary's and St. Anne's intersection. We're trying to get a very long-running piece of public art up at that intersection. Some good cooperation from the landowners here, and I just wanted to praise Ms. Gianfloni for her work through Mr. Kiernan's department to try and get this thing nailed down so we can get this thing built in the 150th anniversary of Canada, because some of the federal funding relied on that, and you're all welcome to come to the opening whenever that may be, sometime in the next few months.
Thank you, Councillor. And I'll just point out, with that reference to the Portage and Main of St. Patel, I have the floor. My understanding is pedestrians are able to cross at that intersection, and yet it still continues. So
I do. out of
you invited it. Thank you very much. Councillor, I'll go over to you.
No comment.
Okay. I will call the question then. Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Carried. Motion to adjourn. All in favor? Carried. Thank you, everyone. Have a great day.